Hi, this is Rich. How you doing? I'm going to do a reaction video on Donald Hoffman. He's professor of cognitive science. And what this is about is that nothing you see is real. This reality that we're in is a construct in consciousness. Now, I've talked about this a lot, but this guy really says it clearly. It's like we're living in a computer game. And a lot of the principles of reality as we understand it are actually understood when you look at how a computer game is played, or a virtual reality game where you bring your consciousness into the gaming environment. Anyway, Donald really says it well. It's only an 8-minute video. I'm going to do a reaction as he's speaking. So here we go. Ready? Here we go.
Space-time. The sun and the moon, physical objects, everything that we see inside of space and time is just our visualization tool.
Now, this is an easy way to like get started if you're trying to understand what the hell he's going to be talking about, is that you can imagine if you're a great vivid visualizer or you're a very good lucid dreamer, the reality or the environment that you're in is created with your imagination. The awareness that you are, the consciousness that you are, is imagining your environment. But a really good visualizer can actually touch and feel and smell the things and imagine a body, and the body that he's in is in the environment. So now he's walking around in the imagined, visualized body that he's manifested in his dream world, in his daydream. And now the people will walk around and touch and feel and experience life in this way through these imaginings, through these visualizations. So he's going to be talking more about the brain and the physical reality and how these bodies and the using our brain is a visualization tool, something like that. Okay, here we go.
The reality we're interacting with is nothing like the visualization tool. It's nothing like space and time. We've made the rookie mistake of assuming that our headset, VR, our visualization tool, is the final reality. It's just a rookie mistake. It's like someone who's played Grand Theft Auto so long, they have no idea there's a reality besides Grand Theft Auto. We're like that right now. If you just look at your face in the mirror, if you look, what you see directly is just skin, hair, and eyes. That's all you see. And if you looked inside, if someone opened your skull up and looked, you just see neurons and so forth. But what you know firsthand that you cannot see is your hopes, your dreams, your aspirations, your love of music, your mood. It's all in the VR experience. No physical object, including my body, is conscious. Strictly speaking, my brain isn't conscious, because my brain, in fact, doesn't even exist unless I render it.
Exactly. Right?
So if you're playing Grand Theft Auto, I'm playing a VR version of it. I got the steering wheel in front of me. I'm holding the steering wheel. If I look to the side, I no longer render the steering wheel, and there is no steering wheel. When I look here, I render it, and now there is a steering wheel.
Okay, so now this is weird. We're talking about that weird reality and how reality really works. Have you ever thought of this? How, like, if you're not there in New York, New York does not exist. Just like in a computer game, you might be on one side of town, and the other side of town does not exist. The computer is not rendering that part of the gaming environment because it doesn't need to. It's saving resources. Yeah, it's stored in memory. It's stored on the hard drive. It's the ability, the code is there to manifest it when you decide to focus on, go around a corner, go across town, go to New York. So then it gets rendered. So is that how reality is? Like the reality outside my wall here, outside the room, doesn't exist until I put my attention, focus, consciousness, and awareness on it, and actually see it with my eyes, smell it, feel it, touch it with the various senses, using my body, which is my virtual reality suit, the consciousness that I am, moves into this virtual reality suit, looking through the eyes of the avatar, the physical body, from that point of view. But the great consciousness is the computer system that is rendering what I'm looking at. Is that how it works? Because we're talking about not just this, but we're talking about what is a matrix? What is the matrix? Are we in a matrix? Why, how, the simulation? You know, the matrix being the, you know, something has gotten all the people in the movie, all the people are imagining or dreaming the same dream, but they're awake in the dream and they don't know it's a dream, but it's all in their imagination. It's kind of like that. So there's a lot to this. Let's see what else he has to say.
The same thing is true, strictly speaking, of neurons and brains. They're there when you render them. They're not there when you don't. It's a VR system that you render objects in space and time as you need them because they're part of your visualization.
This is a professor of neurosciences talking about this stuff. Elon Musk, he talks about this being a simulation. It's deep stuff. There's another great movie besides The Matrix. There's a movie called The 13th Floor. Yeah. And it's about some computer scientists created a computer world, a rendering of it, and then they were able to move into it, and it was lifelike, blah, blah, blah. So that's a pretty good story, too.
And then you garbage collect them. You delete them when you don't need them. Your life and my life right now is we're in a simulator, a space-time simulator, and we've been given, like an AI system, we've been given certain intrinsic desires.
So now we're talking about the AI system, and I've been looking into this too. And you know, you read what you can, you learn what you can on the internet about the AI, artificial intelligence, artificial sentience, synthetic sentience, synthetic intelligence, this sort of stuff. But what is it really? Well, my perspective, my point of view, my understanding of this is that if there is no awareness, there is nothing there to be aware that something else is there. And an artificial intelligence is just computer code, and an awareness, a sentience, a consciousness needs to be there in order for that experience to be rendered or manifested. Everything manifested, the way I see it, is from the imagination. And consciousness has imagination. Awareness has imagination. Sentience has imagination. And it has a knowing, an awareness, consciousness, this sort of stuff. And thus it has attention that it can put on different things. And you can do a lot with that, but if it's an artificial intelligence, like we hear about, you know, the Red Queen or some super art AI that's running around in the multiverse or the galaxy or the universe, and it's overtaking things. Well, it's artificial sentience because it's so much computing power that can imitate what consciousness can do. But it will not exist if the consciousness that is considering life and experience does not consider it. So it cannot take over your life unless you are considering and imagining that it is taking over your life. Now, a lot of our imaginings manifest, a lot of our thoughts will manifest, but we forgot that we've thought them. And when did we think these thoughts? When did we have those feelings? When did we start the process of manifestation? by what we're thinking and feeling and focusing on. How many times have we thought of some negative weird shit before it finally manifests in what we consider our reality right here, right now? But it's just the rendering that is rendered by virtue of the code written and the programming written in consciousness as you imagine and think stuff. Now, because we've been around a very long time, it's not just things you've thought maybe in this lifetime, but things you've been considering in other lifetimes. But when you consider other lifetimes, you're actually not the illusion is that there is time, but it's all happening right now. It's happening on a small scale from the awareness that you consider yourself to be right now. You're aware of your room, your apartment, your house, world events, and all this stuff, the game environment that you're in, the universe you're in, the game universe. But in fact, the greater consciousness that you are is even outside of this game. And it's like the player that you are that has moved into this avatar, and you're living life as this person, this avatar character. Now, that's one personality and character. But outside of that, that game universe timeline, like in a Grand Theft Auto game, the timeline is artificial. It's like you can log out of the game and then log back in later, 2 weeks later, and pick up the game where you left off, or you can start a new game, and you can predict generally the timeline, how it's going to go, but depending on your decisions and how you control the avatar, different things will play out in your world, in your game world. So it is with reality, this physical reality. When we pop out of this game universe, we can come back in and we can log in or start a new game, and we can start like 1,000 years ago, 1,000,000 years ago, 1,000,000 years into the future, 1,000,000,000 years into the future, 1,000,000,000 years into the past, and you can plug in and you can play the game again. And it's like you're reliving a past life, but it's just like you're replaying the game that you played like many years ago, the first time you played Grand Theft Auto, but now you're playing it again, but now you can make new decisions, new outcomes, and different gameplay. So it's kind of all like that, as I understand it. So anyway, this is good stuff, and it's good food for thought, because you are not going to be here forever in the physical universe gaming experience. You're going to be done with this game, and then what are you going to do? Are you addicted to the game? Are you going to come back and you're going to play again and again and again? Are you going to be so immersed in the game that you don't understand that it's a game? And what if you don't want to be so addicted to the game or so occluded and unaware that you're not even aware that it's a game? You think it's like this is how it is, and this is your only choices. It's to live and die on a planet Earth and then be reincarnated, or do you go to heaven, or do you go to hell, or do you go to some purgatory or some other alternate reality or parallel universe? It's all up to you, the consciousness that you are, because it's the awareness, the consciousness, the sentience that you are with this imagination, which is manifesting any reality you'll experience. So any afterlife experience, any beings you engage, whether they're ETs, aliens, reptilians, archons, entities, angels, archangels, any kind of just friends, family, relatives, any kind of being that you're going to experience, and any kind of reality or life you're going to experience outside of the physical universe, is going to be by virtue of what you think, your imaginings and your beliefs and other considerations and decisions, agreements that you've made about what is reality. So you have the potential to expand your reality and be free of all of these grand scenarios and gaming experiences by simply, absorbing this information of what is reality, what is life, what is a simulation, what is the matrix and things like this. So yeah. Okay, here we go.
So my wife is an artist. So there's billions of humans, and there are billions of different ways that we explore in music, in art, in literature, in science, various kinds of science, meditation. So we're at sports. There are all sorts of ways that consciousness is exploring through us. And there is not like one is the best. I don't know what we're doing outside of space and time. That's part of what I want to understand, is what are we actually doing? I don't know what I'm actually doing. I know what I'm doing under a description. Like I'm moving my hand right now, and if I grab a steering wheel in my car, I know what I'm doing under a space-time description, but I don't know in ultimate reality what I'm really doing. It's just like the VR player, when they turn the steering wheel in Grand Theft Auto, they know what they're doing in the language of the game. I'm turning a steering wheel. But what they're really doing in terms of the supercomputer, right, which in that metaphor would be the deeper reality, they're toggling voltages and magnetic fields and circuits that they have no idea. There's probably trillions of voltage togglings going on.
Yeah, it's like we're tapping into just how amazing we really are as conscious creators, playing the role or the game or the character of being not so smart, not so conscious, not so aware, not so intelligent, and not so able, but we really are. The divine intelligence, the God consciousness, intelligence, source, origin, whatever we want to call it, that's you and me. We're like shards of that. We're fragments or fractals of all of that. And it's you and me, it's us. We are creating and manifesting everything from all these different points of view as different individuals. So that makes you every evil being that you ever thought of or imagined. That's the part of the consciousness that you are. And from your perspective here right now, like this, me looking at bad guys and the good guys and the wonderful, helpful beings and guides and friends beyond the physical universe or here in the world. Same with all the evil, bad, and McNasties. I'm imagining all of it. And right here, I'm not imagining in my room, so they do not exist except as an idea, but they are a template or a program that for some people with the same understanding of life and experiences that I have, they've actually manifested those. So you know, they touch and feel and actually experience the engagement with these good beings and harsh beings and evil beings. And for those of us, or those of you who have gotten yourself into a sticky situation, you can't get out of a very uncomfortable, painful, abusive relationship or a lifestyle or something, you know, it's just really icky for you, from your perspective, that it's still you. You did it. But you've gotten so far into the game that you've lost the understanding that that's how it works. And just because, you know, I understand this on a theoretical basis, you know, when things happen, I still get upset that this guy did that, or that thing happened, and I get aggravated. But I'm playing the character, the human being that I'm being. And there is that ability to pop out of this when this body or this avatar is over. You know, it's gone, expired, lived its life, and it was time to out of here, the final out. So where am I going to be? What am I going to be imagining? What are my considerations, my agreements, my understandings, my beliefs about what comes next? Well, the ones that are predominant, those ideas and stuff, will manifest. And you get some ideas and you think and you hope and you wish it'll be like this, but thinking, hoping, wishing your afterlife or what you're going to be doing after you leave here isn't the same thing as what you have programmed within you that is going to be your afterlife. And you have the opportunity right now to understand these kinds of principles and change the programming within you to assure or ensure that you have a better life after you leave here. If you want to go off and do grand and exciting and wonderful things, living as a human being, but not on planet Earth, but in the physical universe, can do. If you want to leave the physical universe experience, what we consider to be 3D Earth reality, you want to leave here and never come back, can do. If you want to go into what we'd call, as a label, the higher astral, heaven worlds, paradise, Valhalla, any other kind of alternate reality or parallel universe, can do. And the ability to reconnect with other aspects of your consciousness, fragments, shards, fractals, bits of you, souls, monads, whatever you want to call them, soul fragments, these you can merge, re-merge with some of those and gain the experience and knowledge that, you know, the two parts of you becoming one, so now you know what the other part of you knows, and it knows what you know, and you're not two individuals merging, you're coming back together as one, but there's so many other parts of you, then you're not merging all of those, but you could, and you could get that what's called God consciousness experience of being all that is. So that's a possibility too. So anyway, the reason I'm doing this reaction video is it's great food for thought. It's somebody else's sharing the very similar perspective that I have and understand as how reality is, the nature of reality. So here we go.
On for one turn of the wheel. All they see is a turn of the wheel. That's their notion of cause and effect. It's trivial. The real cause and effect is trillions of voltages getting toggled in fractions of a second. It's much, much more complicated. So when I talk evolution, I'm only going to be talking about assuming the headset. Now, I'm within the framework of the headset because evolutionary theory is only a headset theory. It's not a theory of consciousness beyond space and time.
Okay, it's more like, you probably get it, but it's like in the game world, Grand Theft Auto, for example, it's the evolution. If you expanded that GTA world for millions and billions of years back into the past, within the context of that gaming world, how did things evolve? Creatures and people and, you know, all that stuff. So in the context of that game, there's evolution of spirit or evolution of man and things. But the consciousness that goes into the game, whether it's a player outside the GTA world sitting at the keyboard, there, how things evolved is not the same. What the consciousness outside the game world sitting at the keyboard looking at the monitor or with their virtual reality headset on and got their haptic stuff going and they're just feeling it and seeing it and experiencing it and they're immersed in the experience, what they know is that whatever the evolutionary theories and facts are in the gaming world, they know that this is code, man. This is computer code. This is a simulation. This is artificial. This is not real outside the context of the game universe, which is, you know, you pull it off the shelf, it's on a disc and you slip it in your PC and it reads the code and it manifests, whether it's flat screen or a 3D immersive or immersion pods, high-tech sort of things like that. The holodeck on Star Trek. Yeah, it's like that. It's pretty neat stuff. I find it really fascinating. Okay, here we go.
Consciousness is like a kid in a candy store. It's a never-ending exploration that is, in principle, never-ending. We call Tom and Don are just parts.
It's never-ending because it's outside of time and space. So if there's a beginning, then, you know, there's a time when something begins and then there's a time when something ends. And if there is no time and there's no space, there is no beginning or end. Anyway, that's another whole fun philosophical subject.
Of this overall exploration of consciousness and all of its possibilities. Our little bit that we're exploring right now, as rich as it seems to us, is trivial compared to all the possibilities that Gödel says are out there. I can imagine a square. I can imagine a cube. Now, go up one more dimension. Imagine a cube in four dimensions. My brain halts and my mind catches on fire. Nothing happens. That's only four dimensions. I can't even go to four dimensions. I mean, that's terrible. It's just an incredible limitation. I can only see three dimensions of color, red, green dimension, blue, yellow, and so forth. There are some pigeons that have four color receptors. Presumably they're in an extra dimension of color that I can't even imagine what it's like. Can you imagine a specific color you've never seen before? As rich as our world seems, we know that there's a rich possibility of conscious experiences that we can't even concretely imagine. But consciousness itself, on this theory, is exploring all these possibilities. And right now we're sort of stuck on this little headset. Three dimensions, small amount of color that we can see, and so forth. We thought it was the whole world. No, it's a little headset. It's a prism. My imagination is stuck in only three dimensions. My colors are stuck in a certain range. Now here's the challenge. Suppose we chase that down. So we say, okay, there's going to be this ongoing dynamics of consciousness constantly going beyond what it knows. But there's going to be a dark side to it, because going into the unknown means letting go of what you know. And that can be terrifying, where literally you don't have concepts. All of your current concepts are inadequate. For those who meditate, I mean, when you go into silence, it's both healing and terrifying.
Okay, let me say, going where you don't know, ooh. To me, the way I would look at that, he's going kind of in a different direction than I would go. What you know, right, is what you know. And that which you don't know has not been manifested yet. It's not experienced because it is not manifest. So in order to go deep, in order to experience that which is unknown, we still have to manifest it. We have to think it into existence. We have to consider it, just simply imagine it. Back to this, let's say you're that person who has a vivid imagination and there's nothing there. It goes deep space and there's one little tiny light and it's a huge massive star. This is your consideration. So it is. But you have to get really, really, you know, it's really far away, but you can see it. So you get up closer to it. And now there's nothing. The unknown is beyond the star. It's only unknown because you consider there's nothing there. There is nothing to know. So as soon as you consider something there, it becomes manifest and you know it. But to play the game, you would consider that you don't know what's beyond on Terrace or that big giant star. So then you sort of, it's like you, again, you're creating a computer game in a computer game world. And so you want to play it in such a way that when you're playing as the avatar in the game, there are things you don't know. But you have to consider that you don't know in order to not know. Anyway, it's just theory and philosophy. Let's continue. Now I want to hear your thoughts on this too. Now, what you think ultimately, what you believe what you want to go with and what is accurate and real for you. That's what counts.
Right? If you really let go of all thoughts and go into the void, it can be scary. Like, you want to go back into, you grab back onto your, it's a life jacket, right? You grab onto your teddy bear, your thoughts. How would consciousness precisely, this vast social network, project mathematically into space-time? Clearly there's a projection. I'm interacting with Tom's consciousness. I'm not seeing that consciousness. I'm seeing skin, hair, and eyes. I'm seeing a space-time projection. I'm not actually seeing your emotions. I'm not seeing your mood. But I am genuinely interacting with your experiences. It's a genuine interaction. And so there is a projection from this conscious realm into space-time. Yeah. We can take what we understand in the headset and pull it backwards. If we can project from consciousness to the headset, then we can try at least to go from the headset and pull backwards. It's a fallible enterprise, but it may help us to open our minds to the possibilities for deeper theories of what's going on outside the headset.
Yeah. So we get to this place as the great consciousness that we all are, the God consciousness, the divine intelligence. We have already the potential of creating anything and everything imaginable. And we basically pretty much already have, but we're not stopping, we're still doing it. But one of those things we've done is create the idea of not knowing and forgetting and mind wipes and amnesia and memory loss and dependence on brain cells for memory. We've done just unbelievable amount of things and considerations to consider ourselves to be the beings that we consider ourselves to be right now. A human being, a being having a human experience, a being who's lost his memory, a being who has lost his abilities or his greater consciousness. These sort of things are considerations, beliefs, we've agreed to it, and we are living the life of the character that we are identifying with. And to pull back or pull outside the headset would be to, and we're looking at the environment and other people's considerations and teachings and presentations to get an understanding, to go back, track back our agreements, our beliefs. And where do we come up with this belief? Where do we decide that, you know, memory is an issue and why I can't remember, you know? And you literally have to start practicing, or you can start practicing, pulling out of being the character that you are. Pull out of being the person you believe yourself to be. Pulling back out of, thus stop creating with thought what you consider yourself to be. Eckhart Tolle talks about this when he talks about, and other philosophers too, you know, it's the second death or the inner dying thing. The personality and the character, which is ego self, who you think you are, dies as an idea, set. And then when you can let go of that, you stop thinking, if you really get into your, you know, the profound meditation, so you stop thinking these thoughts on such a deep and profound level, you stop thinking into existence the character, the personality, the being that you've always thought you were. And you, who you always believed yourself to be, ceases to exist. And then it's back to the unknown. The character you're being doesn't know what that would be like. And so when the character that you're being starts to consider, ooh, what would that be like? The character doesn't know, you don't know. But if you can get into that condition, situation, or state of consciousness, it is very profound. And you can read different stories. One good one is Power Versus Force is a great book of a guy who was able to achieve that state and wrote a great book about it. So yeah, good stuff, huh? I like it.
So the reason I'm doing this is because I can't even imagine a specific color that I've never seen before. I can't imagine in four dimensions. In other words, I take it as a given that I'm deeply, deeply limited in my imagination.
Yeah.
And I need all the tools I can get to help me step outside of my headset and try to guess the unfathomable outside of there.
Now, this is one of the reasons I got into the out-of-body experience, consciousness shifting. You're moving the consciousness out of being this beingness, and you're free to roam and move and explore what I call the multiverse, various planes, dimensions, densities, belief system territories, things like this. So I've had a lot of out-of-body experiences, and so I've gone into a lot of places that are outside of this reality system, this matrix, this simulation, this reality. But I am still maintaining some identification with the idea of who and what I really am. The idea being that I am a spirit being, a spiritual being that can move and travel outside of the context of a physical body and outside of the physical universe experience. But those are still ideas that the awareness that I am is keeping in play as a way to identify who and what I believe myself to be. So, again, wow. All right. Thanks, Tom. Wow, good stuff, huh? All right. Guess that's it, folks. Thank you for watching, and you know, your comments and your thoughts about reality and simulations, and do we live in a simulation? Have you ever been out of this physical reality experience? Have you ever gotten that mind, that state of consciousness, where you cease to be the being that you believe yourself to be, that God consciousness thing? You ever gotten that? All right. Thanks for watching. Take care of yourself. Bye-bye.